Assalamu alaikum everyone. So this is the 16th lecture and this is the first lecture overseas, and I guess my lectures got a bit delayed. So the topic for this lecture is routing metrics. So what we're going to see in this lecture is what different kinds of metrics are used to, you know, measure the performance of a link or maybe the entire network and how they're calculated. So at the beginning, what we need to learn is what are routing metrics. So routing metrics are basically values assigned to a route or a path, and once the value for each route or path is known, it can be used to calculate the throughput of the entire network. So the value that is assigned to any router path indicates the extent of performance. So it might be that the larger value indicates a good performance and the smaller value indicates bad, or it might also be vice versa. So this value is used by a routing algorithm to determine which route will be selected for the path in the path from source to destination. Okay, so it is actually used to select the entire path from the source to destination, and it can be also used to, you know, select more than one routes based on the sorted values of or the performance values of the routing metrics according to the routing metrics. So this value reflects the cost of using the route with respect to some optimization objective. So there might be multiple optimization objectives, and we'll see those objectives later on. And there can be different objectives as well. So one is the different ways that an objective can be represented using a value, and the objectives themselves can be of different types as well. So the metrics determine which constraint or performance is emphasized, okay? So for example, if you want to emphasize, let's say, power or electricity used, then the metric might be different. And if you want to, let's say, optimize the distance traveled or the time taken for a packet to reach from source to destination, then the metric might be different, okay? So one of the most commonly used and the most simplest routing metric is the hop count. So this basically means the number of hops required for a packet to reach the destination from the source. And one hop basically means one link. So let's say if node 1 wants to reach the destination 4, and there are multiple nodes from the source to destination. So after 1, the node 2 is reached. That means 2 is directly connected to 1, and then 3 is directly connected to 2, and 4 is directly connected to 3. So this means we have a path from 1 to 2 to 3 to 4. So there are 3 links in between, and the entire path consists of these 3 links. So each link is actually called a hop, and the number of hops required in this scenario is 3. So the hop count is 3. So this is how a hop count is actually measured, okay? But we're going to see many more metrics. So these are some of the optimization objectives which determine the routing metrics. So the first one is the most used one, which is minimizing the delay. That means the time required for the packet to reach from the source to the destination. And there might also be objectives like maximizing the probability of data delivery. So the time required might be more, but the probability of successful transmission is more important here, even if the delay is larger. And then maximizing the path throughput might also be taken as an optimization objective. So this means even if any a specific link in the path might require more time, but the entire path in itself is more efficient compared to other paths. So this is the maximizing path throughput. And the next is maximizing network throughput. So in this scenario, we might sacrifice, you know, path throughput for the greater good. That means if the entire network gives a better throughput value, if let's say some specific path is not optimized, then network throughput might also be maximized. So this is another objective. And then let's say minimizing energy consumption is also optimization objective. But why do we need energy consumption, you might be thinking? Because they might have electricity throughout the entire period, but we're going to see the reason. And then there's also distributing traffic load. So this means, let's say, a switch might have are a huge number of queries that it has to process, and then it might be that it cannot process so many queries at a time, and as a result some of the packets are delayed. So even though this route is actually the best path that the specific packet has to take, but still another path may be taken so that the traffic load is minimized. Okay, so based on the different optimization objectives, the path might differ, and based on this different routing matrix, the algorithm selects the different routes. So the challenges in wireless networks sort of dictate what routing metric or what optimization objective might be selected. So for example, node mobility. In case of wireless networks, the nodes are mobile, right? So that has to be taken into consideration, that nodes are moving, and establishment of connection between the moving nodes has also be need to be taken into account. And then there's the wireless propagation phenomena. That means the transmission is now wireless, it's not wired. So this might, you know, cause a change in the speed or in the corruption of the packets, and all these have to be taken into account when sending a packet. For example, in case of wired networks, it's not very important to consider whether the data was successfully transmitted or not, because it's almost certain that the data will be transmitted successfully. But in case of wireless, it has to be taken into account. The third thing is energy constraints. So this should answer the previous question of why do we need to minimize energy consumption. So the question here is, as the nodes are wireless, so that means they do not have access to wired electricity, or they do not have a constant supply of energy, because they might be battery powered. So here the question of, you know, minimization of energy comes into account, and we have to also consider the route which uses or wastes the least amount of energy. And then there's also lack of centralized control. So depending on whether there's a centralized control or not, the routing metric might vary. So these are the different challenges which need to be considered when selecting a routing metric. So this is one example of routing metric. In fact, we're going to see three or four routing metrics. So this is called expected transmission count, or in short ETX. So what this routing metric does is it considers the amount of transmissions which are required to send a packet successfully. So for example, we can see in this figure that there are already some transmissions shown here. For example, in the first scenario, the let's say this node is sending a packet to this node, and it was able to send the packet successfully to only one transmission. So we can say that one transmission was required and the delivery ratio is 100%. In the second scenario, we can see that the first transmission was unsuccessful or a failure, and the second transmission was successful. So the number of transmissions required was 2, and the delivery ratio or the throughput was 50%. Okay. And in the third scenario, the first two transmissions were unsuccessful, and only the third transmission was successful. So we can say that the number of transmissions required were 3, and the delivery ratio was 1/3, which is 33%. So how are these values calculated? We can see here. So the link throughput is equal to 1 divided by the link expected transmission count. So if the expected transmission count is 2, then the link throughput is 1/2, which is 50%. If the expected transmission count, that means the number of transmission required to successfully send the data packet, is 1, then the link throughput is 1/1, which is 100%. And if the number of packets the number of transmissions required is 3, then the throughput is 1/3, which is 33%. Okay, so how is this calculated actually? So this might depend on the protocol. So for example, in IEEE 802.11, link layer acknowledgements are there and retransmissions are also there. So if there are no retransmissions, then actually there is no point of calculating the link expected transmission count, because after just sending one packet, it will not send any other packet. So there is no point of calculating the ETX. And then again, as there are acknowledgements, so these the transmission counts of the acknowledgement packets also need to be considered. So if we consider both the data packet and the acknowledgement packet, then the probability of a successful transmission is equal to the probability of the data packet success multiplied by the probability of the acknowledgement success. Okay, so why is this? Because even if a data packet is sent but no acknowledgement is received, then it is assumed that the transmission was a failure. So as a result, both the probability of the data packet and the probability of the acknowledgement packet needs to be taken into account. Okay, so as we got the transmission success probability, we can use this to calculate the expected transmission count of a link. So the expected transmission count is equal to 1 divided by the probability of transmission success, or it can be broken down into this. That means 1 divided by the probability of data packet success multiplied by the probability of acknowledgement success. Okay, so if you want to, you know, go through this in the previous case, so let's say for this link, for the second link, we can say that the probability of sending a data packet is 50, right, or 0.5. So if you want to, you know, calculate the link expected transmission count using 0.5, so 1 divided by 0.5 means 2. So this means that the expected transmission count for this link is 2, so which is exactly the case here, right? So in this way, you can actually calculate the throughput from the expected transmission count, and again, you can also calculate the expected transmission count from the throughput. So this is how they are calculated theoretically, but how do we calculate them in the real scenario? So to understand that, we have to, you know, understand two things. One is the forward delivery ratio, and the second thing is the reverse delivery ratio. Okay, so we can equate the probability of data packet success to the forward ratio. Okay, and we can equate the acknowledgement success to the reverse ratio. Okay, so if acknowledgement and data are equated to forward and reverse, that means the link expected transmission count can also be written as 1 divided by R forward and R reverse. Okay, so these are just two notations used instead of, you know, data success and acknowledgement success. So now we're going to see how to find out this R forward and R reverse in a real network. So at the very beginning, each node in network broadcasts small link probes. Okay, so these are just small packets of the size 134 bytes, and each packet is sent once per second. So, and the nodes remember probes received over the past 10 seconds. So if, let's say, one packet required more than 10 seconds to, you know, return back to the node, so that means that packet cannot be calculated, or the transmission count for that packet cannot be calculated. But usually it does not take so much time, because the packets travel very quickly. So at first, the reverse delivery ratio is estimated. So the reverse delivery ratio is equal to the packets received divided by the packets sent. So how does this come to be? So the packets received means the number of packets that were sent by the receiver, not the sender. So this means the number of packets received by the sender is equivalent to what? The packets sent by the receiver. Okay, so, and again, the packets sent, so that means the packets that were sent by the sender. So this might seem a bit confusing, so I'm going to draw this. So let's say this is a node, and let's say this is another node. So when I'm sending a data packet and I am receiving a data packet, that means the acknowledgement. So this can be, I'm just writing this as the D and writing this as A for acknowledgement. Okay, so when a data packet is sent and an acknowledgement is received, then we can say that it was a successful transmission. Okay, so if I am talking from the perspective of the source, and in this scenario, the reverse means the probability of receiving the acknowledgement, right? So in this scenario, it is said that the R reverse is equal to the packets received divided by the packets sent. So the packets received means the number of acknowledgements that were received. Okay, and the packets sent means the number of packets that were successfully received here, that means by the receiver. Okay, so if I divide the number of packets received, that means this one, by the number of packets sent, then what I get is actually the reverse ratio, or the number of acknowledgement packets that were successfully received, or I can also call it the probability of the probability of success of the acknowledgement packets. Okay, so this is the reverse ratio, and then the forward delivery ratio is obtained from the piggybacked neighbors. Okay, so that means, let's say the acknowledgement is received. So when the acknowledgement is received, with the acknowledgement, let's say if this is a packet, along with the acknowledgement, some extra data is also there. So this is the acknowledgement part, and then this part contains, let's say, the data information. So that means this part contains the amount of packets that were successfully received by the receiver. So if we have three values, one is the number of packets received by the source and number of packets sent by the receiver, then we know, or we can calculate, the probability of acknowledgement packets. And if we have the number of packets sent by the source and the number of packets successfully received by the receiver, then we can calculate the probability of the data packet. Okay, so in this way, these three values are used to calculate the reverse ratio and the forward ratio. Okay, so even then, if this seems a bit confusing, you can always ask me about this in the discussion class that we are going to have on Monday. So that is how actually the link ratios are calculated, and using those link ratios, the link expected transmission counts are also calculated. So in this slide, what we're going to see is how the route expected transmission count is calculated. So this is basically the sum of all the link expected transmission counts. Okay, so for example, in the first and second scenario, we only have one link. So in this case, the expected transmission count of the link is equivalent to the expected transmission count of the route. So for the first one, one packet or one transmission was required for the successful transmission, so the route ETX is 1. And for the second scenario, two transmissions were required, so the route transmission or expected transmission count is 2. In the third scenario, we have two links here, so it required actually two transmissions, right? Even though there are two links and each link required only one transmission, but overall we can say that the route required two transmissions for the node to reach the destination. So as a result, the route expected transmission count is 2 and the throughput is 50%. So similarly, in this scenario, for two links it required three transmissions, so the route expected transmission count is 3 and the throughput is 33%. And in the last scenario, we have three links and five transmissions were required for successful transmission. As a result, the route expected transmission count is 5 and the throughput is 20%, because it's 1/5. So this is how the route expected transmission count is calculated from the link expected transmissions. Okay, so there are some limitations with expected transmission count. The first one is the link probes are susceptible to MAC unfairness and hidden terminals. So that means if they're hidden terminals, then they will interfere with the probe sending and the calculation of the links, okay, or the link metrics. And also, if multiple probes are transmitted at the same time, because we need to broadcast, right, if you remember. So in that scenario, what happens is, if multiple probes are trying to access the channel at the same time, then there's some MAC unfairness there, because there might be collision, or they have to contend for channel access. As a result, the link measurement cannot be taken properly, and also the ETX measurements change under load. So this is actually covered by what I said already, because when there's many packets trying to, you know, access, or many nodes trying to access the channel at the same time, that means there's a huge load, then the measurements change, even though this load is not supposed to be present here. This is only present because of broadcasting of the probes. The second limitation is the expected transmission count estimates are based on the measurements of a single link probe of size 134 bytes. Okay, but the normal data packets can actually be larger in size, and the acknowledgement packets are usually smaller in size. So what happens is, this metric underestimates the data loss ratios, because the data, there will be more loss in case of data packets, because the data packets are larger in size. And it also overestimates the acknowledgement loss ratio, because the acknowledgement packets will be smaller in size. As a result, there will not be so much loss as expected when we are calculating ETX. Okay, So ETX also assumes that all links run at one bitrate, because we're only counting the number of packets sent for successful transmission, but we're not taking into account the time required for each transmission or the speed of each transmission. Okay, so this is where expected transmission time comes in, or ETT. So expected transmission count does not consider congestion. So this means the traffic or load. So whenever many packets are being sent at the same time, so it does not consider that, right? We already talked about that. But the expected transmission time considers this, because now it is also calculating the time required to send a transmission. So under congestion, the time required will also increase. So this incorporates throughput into its calculation. So how is it calculated? So expected transmission time is equal to expected transmission count into the size of the probing packet, or S, divided by the measured bandwidth of the link. Okay, so if the bandwidth is more, then the transmission time will be less, because the the speed will be more. And again, if the size of the packet is larger, then the time required will be more. So this is why S is at the top and B is at the bottom. Okay, so this is how the transmission time, or expected transmission time, is calculated. Okay, so that was expected transmission time, and although it covers most of the failures of expected transmission count, what it fails to consider is the weights of the links. So what does the weights of the links mean? So let me just draw this. So if, let's say, we have one node here and another node here, and let's say another node here, okay, so that means there are two links in between. This is one link and this is another link. So in case of expected transmission count, what we did was add the values that we got here. For example, if this is xx, so if this is x and let's say this is y, so in case of expected transmission count, we added x and y. So this is also same in case of expected transmission time. The only difference is we are considering time instead of probability or success, the number of packets required to transmit successfully. So the addition is still there, but the problem here is the addition is not an exact representation of the entire route. So for example, this route might require more time, and this link might require less time. Okay, so even then, when it is added, the summed value or the added value that we get is only considered, but the specific link weight is not considered, because the second link might be very heavily loaded. So what this does, or this routing metric does, is it gives weight to every link. Okay, so the link metric values that we did for the previous scenarios are not appropriate for path metric. They are only appropriate for the links. Okay, so when we are concatenating multiple links, that means we're actually adding multiple links to create one path, then the specific links might interfere. So what this means is the value we get for each link, okay, and adding them up, they are not accurate when we are actually sending a packet from the source to the destination, because then there's a more higher probability of interference in a specific link. So WCETT, or weighted cumulative expected transmission time, considers this into account. So this metric is quite complex, so I'm not going to explain this in detail, but only in brief. Okay, so to avoid dominating the value through a bottleneck. What does a bottleneck mean? So if in a path a specific link has a very low bandwidth, or let's say a very high failure rate, then that link will determine what the value for the entire path is. Okay, so in order to control that thing, a constant is introduced, which is called beta. Okay, so the advantage of this routing metric is it solves the problem of link to path ratio. That means it gives a more accurate representation of a path compared to expected transmission time. But the disadvantage is it's a very complex metric, and it is not clear if it can be computed in polynomial or less time. Okay, so these are the routing metrics that we're going to learn for today. The first one is expected transmission count, and we also saw what was, let's say, hop count, right? So hop count is very simple, so that's why I didn't explain it in detail. But then we learned expected transmission count, and then we learned expected transmission time, and at the end we learned weighted cumulative expected transmission time. Okay, so that was it for today. And if you have any questions regarding this, because it might be a bit complex, then you can ask in the post as well, in Google Classroom, or you can, you know, comment in YouTube, or you can also you know, knock me in any personal platform. So as I will not be available to regular calls, so you have to knock me through online. Okay, so that was it, I guess. Assalamualaikum everyone.